Shruti, you can start.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Shruti Ashokar, student of Symbiosis University. I welcome you all in this wonderful session with the topic, Restoring Tropical Forest of Eastern Himalaya. Forest comprises not only the trees and plants, but their habitat for birds, animals, and wildlife. Their restoration benefits not only forest quality and quantity, but enhances food security, improves water and air quality, climate change resilience, conserves plant and animal species, and many more. To provide us with the more and detailed information, we have our guest with us. I would like to introduce our speaker, Nupur Borwake ma'am. She is an ecologist with a bachelor's degree in botany from Ferguson College and master's degree in biodiversity from Garhwari College, Pune. Her primary interest lies in studying plant ecology and especially restoration ecology. She had worked as a public engagement and outreach officer for wildlife conservation for a short period at Wildlife Research and Conservation Society, Pune. She has got an opportunity to work as a visiting faculty at Ferguson and Modern College, Pune, where she taught environmental awareness and plant ecology to BSc, BA, MSc students for a while. Currently, she is working in the Nature Conservation Foundation, Bangalore. She has been managing the Rainforest Restoration Project, which is based in Arunachal Pradesh since 2018. Her present work has allowed her to witness and understand human impacts on tropical forests through habitat loss, degradation, and fragmentation. As a part of their humble efforts, ma'am and her team are trying to reverse the negative impact on biodiversity through forest restoration in the landscape. We all welcome you, ma'am. Now, I will request all the participants to keep themselves on mute. Chat box will be disabled during the session, so you all can note your questions and ask after the session. Now I request you, ma'am, to start the session. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you so much, Shruti. Thank you. Thank you for having me here. Usually I get to interact with people who have been working in the same field, like the ecology background or science background or even other restoration, ecological restoration practitioners. But this is an entirely different audience for me. And I have toned it down to the level of understanding for you all, so that you get to know about restoration, what it is exactly, and what we have been doing. And I'm very much glad that I'm able to do this, and you have started this initiative, because it is very much needed that students from other backgrounds, other streams, should also sort of know things about conservation. Because in a way, the youth only, will take it ahead to, save the environment. So with that, I'll start my presentation. And you can, anybody can interrupt me if there's some issue with the audio or something. So just let me know. I'll start the presentation now. Is the screen visible yet?
No, ma'am, not yet.
Okay. Is it visible now?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, so the topic that I'll be talking about is forest restoration. And we have been carrying out this in the Eastern Himalayan landscape, which is considered to be a biodiversity hotspot. So biodiversity hotspot in the sense that there is a rich diversity of wildlife that is present there. The forest types are unique due to the geological conditions of this entire landscape. So Eastern Himalaya, it's a big stretch. So it covers Bhutan, some parts of China, the northeastern belt of India. So out of this Eastern Himalayan stretch, where we work is the northeastern area, and the state where I work is Arunachal Pradesh. So this is the, I can show you how the Pakeh Tiger Reserve looks like. So there's a core zone. Pakeh Tiger Reserve, it's a protected area. It's one of the tiger reserves of India. And it has core zone, which is entirely protected, and there's no hunting or any other such activities that are allowed in this area. It is surrounded by various reserve forests and also other protected areas like the Nameri Tiger Reserve you see here. And it's like situated amidst a lot of other protected areas. So this is where I work, and I'll like to show you a small video where, which describes the Paakhi Tiger Reserve and how the forest looks like. Okay.
Paakhi Tiger Reserve is a very special place. It's home to a huge number of animal species. Among the most special group of species that's there are the hornbills.
So this was a short video. So you must have seen that how diverse and the kind of wildlife that is present in Paakhi Tiger Reserve. So, I mean, not only you must have seen lots of animals there, but there are many different types of tree species, shrub species, orchids that are present in this forest. And it's a tropical semi-evergreen forest type. So it has an intricate structure, which I'll be describing a bit later. So I'll give you a background of the work that we have been doing in this landscape for the past 2 decades. So I have joined the Nature Conservation Foundation, and we work under the Eastern Himalaya program of the Nature Conservation Foundation. But I have joined recently, but we have been working in this landscape. Dr. Aparajita Datta, who is my supervisor, she has done her PhD way back in 1950s, where she has worked on you know, different aspects of the vegetation there, the wildlife there. She has worked on hornbills especially. And since then, she has continued working in that landscape and developing her research. So we have worked on different aspects of hornbills, squirrels, the primates. That primates are basically monkeys, that are the monkey species that are present. We have also tried to understand the tree frugivore interaction. So what are frugivores? Are basically the birds who feed on fruits. So how they are linked and how it has helped in the seed dispersal in this landscape. So we have also worked on plant phenology, vegetation composition and structure. So what plant phenology basically means is we monitor different trees, like for how they have been, if there is a change with climate in the fruiting, flowering or leaf flushing pattern in these forests. So based on these different research that we have been carrying out in this area, slowly, slowly we got to know and we have seen a change in this landscape. Dr. Aparajita, when she was working in this landscape, it was very intact, and you know, the protected area, which is Paakhi Tiger Reserve, was declared as a protected area much later. Earlier, there was some sort of logging that was done by the local people there. Hunting was also rampant. Later on, it was declared as a protected area. But she has seen the change in this landscape in these 2 decades that she has worked in this landscape. So, like I said, that she has worked, much of the work what we have done in this landscape is on hornbills. So we have looked at various, you know, like right from behavioral studies of hornbills, how they're feeding or how is the breeding ecology, if there are impacts of the logging and hunting on, you know, the hornbill numbers or the abundances, how is it affecting the seed dispersal in this area? And if, you know, the loss of hornbill will affect, how it will affect the forest regeneration, because these are the species which are very much necessary, and these are called as farmers of the forest, because what these special birds they do is they feed on large seeded fruits, and they disperse the seeds to long distances. So from the parent plant they carry these seeds to different areas where the mother plant is, from the area where the mother plant is present to a longer distances, so that there is natural forest regeneration of different species that keeps happening, and the diversity of the forest is maintained. And my colleague Karishma Pradhan, she'll soon be talking about this, and it is going to be an interesting session that I can say. So now coming to the forest type that where we work in, it's the rainforest, and rainforests are very intricate, and there are multiple tiers in a rainforest. So what I mean by tiers is, like, right from the forest floor to the tallest tree, there are different layers, and in these different layers there is a wide variety of tree species, right from tree species to animal species that are dependent, and that is how the rainforest looks like. So I'll show you a video where it has been described how a rainforest looks like.
An intact canopy acts like a protective blanket. It is so dense that very little direct sunlight reaches the ground. The canopy helps maintain a stable environment under which the rest of the forest grows and regenerates. A rainforest also has multiple layers in its structure. The forest floor is humid and moist and covered in leaf litter. It is under these conditions that the rainforest seeds germinate. The shrub layer above the forest floor forms the mid-story. It is composed of woody plants that provide spaces for animals that live near the forest floor. Above this is the canopy that forms the cover and has its own unique set of plants and animals. The arboreal diversity of a rainforest is dependent on this layer. The multi-tiered structure of a rainforest is very important. If this is affected, the diversity also gets affected.
So this was a short video which describes, I hope everyone was able to see this. If not, I can talk about it again during the discussion that we have after the talk. So, like it's described in this video, that if the layers, the different layers that this rainforest is made of, if it is disturbed, it can affect various animal or birds or insect species that are dependent on these different layers. So now coming to the part where, everybody knows how things have changed in the recent times, how not only recent times, but since the development by humans have started, how things have changed, how the forests have been, you know, cleared for human needs, for urbanization, and for different to satisfy different needs of humans. So what I'd like to highlight here is that there is highest rate of forest loss which is observed in our continent, that is in the Asian tropic, where we live. So what has happened is, because of this high rate of forest loss, these biodiverse landscapes, what they have been converted or transformed is into very biologically poor landscapes, because of which many of the species have, the numbers have gone down. Many of the species have gone extinct because of this forest loss that's happening. So what could be the reasons because of which there is this forest loss happening? So like I mentioned, it is mainly because of the human dependence or the human needs that have led to the forest loss. So things like logging. So if we talk about Asian tropics, so what are the main drivers of forest loss here is basically logging. So rampant logging, clearing of forests to make roads, or for infrastructure developments, or things like converting the area for cultivation. So things like, you must have seen areas where the forest has been cleared and there's rubber plantation, or there are different trees which are with different cash crops, or things like you know, which the humans will gain some benefit from, for which the land has been converted to tree plantations. Things like mining has become a huge problem. Then there are things like illegal encroachment, where people have encroached upon areas which have been declared as protected or are reserve forests. But since because of very poor law enforcement, well, this has happened that there is an encroachment that is seen in this landscape. So many of these reasons, I've mentioned only a few of them, which has resulted in forest loss. But these are the major drivers. So you can see in the pictures that how to the right, top right, you can see how the forest, you can see there are scattered trees. So these are not, you'll see that it looks green, but these are not forested areas, but these are monoculture plantations. For example, oil palm has been planted, or rubber plantations. So similarly, if we come to the landscape where I work in, so like how the Asian tropics, there has been forest loss, here in the Arunachal landscape also we have seen changes. So I'll show you how the landscape has changed. Sorry, this video.
In the last decade, from 90s, was a huge deforestation happened towards Shonitpur district in the adjoining Assam side, where a large chunk of forest has disappeared. Over the years, as we monitored the nests in the tiger reserve, as the number of nest trees in tiger reserve increased, the few nests that we knew in the RF were either cut down or they were abandoned and disturbed. You know, the birds were not successful nesting there. We felt that there was a need to try and protect the hornbill habitat outside the park.
So in this video, you see that's Dr. Aparajita Datta, my supervisor, who's been talking about the landscape and the changes that have happened in this landscape. So since our work mainly was focused on hornbills, while working on the nesting, while looking at the nesting and other aspects of hornbill breeding biology, what we realized is that many of the nests slowly started to get abandoned. Like the hornbills were not nesting in many of these areas because there was a lot of disturbance that was observed. So why we started forest restoration project in this area was mainly to conservation of the hornbill habitat, and in turn we are saying it to be for the conservation of hornbill habitat, but if we revive the forest, it will also benefit the other wildlife species in this area. So now coming to a question that I like to ask everyone, if deforestation is such a big problem, then reforestation is the solution is what everybody would think. But is that so? Is reforestation enough to tackle the problem of deforestation? So here why I say, ask you all, or put this question across, that is reforestation similar to restoration? So many people believe, or there's this misconception, that any kind of, green, if you see a green cover, you think that it's good, or it's a forested area and you see it to be green, so there's no disturbance, is what people feel like. But what I'd like to highlight here is that reforestation basically means planting any kind of tree Or, you know, it can be, for example, here into the left, I've shown monoculture plantation. So only single species are planted, or only specific species which are required for maybe human needs or which are readily available are planted to increase the green cover in an area. So I would like to say that this reforestation, where any kind of species will be planted, it may not be a native species. I'll talk about what a native and non-native species is a bit later. So how restoration is different from reforestation. So basically in forest restoration, what basically happens is we try to revive the different strata or layers that are there in a forest. So it's not just planting or increasing the green cover, but we try to restore as many species that were present in the area, a surrounding area of that degraded patch, so that it will help a lot of wildlife that are dependent on these different forest species. So to the right, as you can see, there are different layers you see in the picture, you can see. And it's not only the green cover, but because of restoration, like having a proper forest cover, you'll also have other benefits like water, the soil will be nourished and things like that. So what is ecological restoration? So it's a simple definition by Society of Ecological Restoration that's been given, which is, it is a process of assisting the recovery of an ecosystem that has been degraded, damaged, or destroyed. So we are trying to recover the entire ecosystem. So it's not just, you know, to show that there's some planting that has been done, but it's an entire ecosystem that we think about when we try and do the restoration. Of course, we may not be able to get back to a perfect or an intact forest kind of an ecosystem, but we try to go or to reach towards that goal while restoring. So I'd like to tell you all about, you know, how and what is the process that goes into restoration and what happens when a forest is degraded. So there is this concept called climax forest. Climax forest is basically a forested area which you can say is an intact forest. Many disturbances or human-led activities because of which you may not be able to see a proper and intact, what we call an intact forest anymore. But more or less the area which is less disturbed, where you can see different layers clearly of a forest, that is called as climax forest. You can see that in the picture to the left. So it has different layers, right, from grasses to shrubs to tall trees. And here, of course, I have only shown the tree species, but many different wildlife depend on these different layers. So if this climax forest is disturbed, then this climax forest, for example, from this group of tree species, if you selectively log, that is, some tree species are logged from this forest, so what would happen is these tall trees would vanish and it would result into an area where only shrubs or more or less the maximum number of forest species which will be seen are the shrubs. If further disturbance is caused in an area by clear cutting, that these shrubs are also cleared, maybe for cultivation or any other activities, or for urbanization or for infrastructure development, then what results is in the formation of an area which looks like a grassland. This grassland, if it is further cleared off entirely for, say, cultivation, for crop cultivation, so what would happen is you will just have bare earth where you'll be planting trees or you'll be planting crops basically for your use. So that is how this works. I mean, if there is disturbance, then slowly these different layers, they get degraded. But nature has its own course. So it tries to go back to, achieve this climax forest. The bare earth will, you know, slowly it will start developing grasses if it is. But there's a big condition in this, if it is undisturbed, if it is left undisturbed. So this process is basically called ecological succession. So like there are successive stages, and in the end you reach an area where you see different layers of an intact forest. But what has happened is this ecological succession process has, you know, been disturbed by various activities. For example, the constant disturbance by humans is one thing. But there could be also things like there are lack of seeds in an area. For example, if Pakeh Tiger Reserve, which is surrounded by many different forested areas, is what I told you. But what if the surrounding reserve forests are totally degraded and there is no source of seeds to come to these degraded areas to for the shrubs or the forest trees or the grasslands to come up in that area? So because of these things, also things like presence of weeds, which is a very serious problem, because these weeds, they compete with the other species that try to, you know, disperse or come to an area. And because of this presence of weeds, the the forest doesn't really or isn't able to get back to the structure that is required. So basically, to assist this process, what we do, as an intervention, what we do is restoration. So what restoration basically does is it removes the barriers to this succession process and tries to accelerate it. So things like I said, all these disturbance, lack of seeds, presence of weeds. So these are all barriers to, this process of ecological succession, where the forest can be revived. So in restoration, what we do is we try to remove these barriers and try to accelerate this process. But I would like to say that the more disturbed the ecosystem, you'll require a lot of time to get it back to the, I won't say get it back to the previous condition, because that is, I can say, nearly impossible, because you can't get what exactly the forest, how the structure was. But to achieve that maximum diversity, it will take a longer period. So this is what is restoration. To tell you in brief, is what restoration means. Slide has got stuck. I'll start sharing again. I'm sorry, there's some issue. Yeah. So coming to the situation in and around Pakeh Tiger Reserve, this I have said this multiple times, but would like to highlight it again. So you might think that since Pakeh Tiger Reserve is a protected area, why is there a need for restoration in this, inside the protected area or surrounding landscape, which is a reserve forest, which is also protected. But I'd like to tell you that outside Pakeh, there has been a very alarming rates of deforestation that are happening because of the illegal logging and the timber mafia that are that have been cutting off tall trees and disrupting the landscape inside Pakeh. Also, before this area was declared as a protected area, like I said, there was selective logging, that is, certain species were logged in the earlier times, and these species have, because of the presence of weeds, heavy weed infestation, there is the regeneration, or like I had mentioned in the previous slide, how the process of ecological succession proceeds. So because of the weed infestation, the forest hasn't been able to regrow. So and many of the protected areas, this is the case in many of the protected areas. So it is also important to revive these, because these are one of the last wildlife refuges that are left, I can say. And also, I'd like to stress that it is an important wildlife habitat. Why we thought of doing restoration here? So we started off with the thought of protecting the hornbill habitat or reviving the hornbill habitat. But there are other wildlife species that are present in this landscape, are the flagship species like elephants and tigers. And because of this history of past human disturbance, there are degraded areas. So because of which we thought that this area needs restoration. So what we started off as goals in our program, I'd like to list some of them. So basically we started restoration for restoring the degraded rainforest for wildlife conservation. That was the main goal of this program. We also thought of growing trees which would be beneficial for the local villagers as well, because you don't have access to a wide variety of species in different nurseries, because they'll mostly be growing some commercially things like which are useful for avenue plantation. So things like that, or ornamental trees. So we thought that this would be beneficial for the local people as well. And we also we think that it's very much important to make people aware of what kind of degradation is happening and why is it necessary for restoration in this landscape. So we do some training, outreach activities as well. So coming to the different methods of restoration, so I'd briefly touch upon this. So there are different types of methods of restoration. One is passive restoration. So what is passive restoration is basically we are trying to assist the natural regeneration. So I had mentioned that restoration is basically assisting natural regeneration, but in certain areas, in certain forested areas, you need to have an active intervention of planting trees. So why I say that is what I'll explain what is passive restoration, and then I'll come to the other method, which is active restoration. So in what I mean by assisting natural regeneration is in certain areas there are trees that are already present in the landscape, but there are little disturbances or some part of the forest layers have been damaged. So there could be different reasons to which, like natural forest fires. So things like prevention of fire can be done by having fire lines. So in this picture, you see that if you have fire lines, if there is a forest fire, case of forest fire, the fire won't cross this line, and in a way, the other part of the area would be saved. Or things like prevention of livestock grazing. So like I had mentioned that there's illegal encroachment. So things, even if there are many protected areas where there's no livestock grazing or any such activities, it's been prohibited, but still there is grazing that is observed, because many people are dependent on these, the forested areas, and the livestock has to go to these areas. So if these livestock grazing is prevented, that would also help the forest to regenerate, because as the grazing is stopped, then the trees would or the grasses would start growing, and that process of ecological succession would continue. And also things like manual weeding around the naturally regenerating saplings. So if there are saplings that you see in an area, there are naturally regenerating saplings, but because of the presence of weeds, these weeds, they grow so fast that they try to outcompete these other species that are growing. And so things like weeding around that sapling would also benefit it, and there would be better growth that can be observed. So this is what is passive restoration. So passively, we are not doing any active planting or things like that. We are just trying to assist the natural regeneration process. Now, it is like a very much intensive activity that needs to be done for the recovery of forests. So basically this is done in areas which are highly degraded and there's no natural regeneration that is observed, or saplings or any kind of trees, or many minimum trees are observed in such areas. We do what can be done is active restoration. because we have to, you know, fasten the process of recovery. If we, say that the nature will take its course and get back to the natural condition of the forests or the landscape, it might take longer than we expect. So there are different steps in this, right from species selections to seed collection, and all these points I'll describe in brief in my later slides. So there are different steps in active restoration. So it, like I said, it's an intensive thing. So we have to, first of all, start with recognizing the forest type. Why this is important is because you have to know the forest type, or if whether there was a forest in an area or not, before even starting to think about, reviving it. Because what if there was no forest there, but it was a grassland habitat. So you can't go and plant trees there, because that grassland habitat will have unique biota or wildlife or, species dependent on it. So you can't disrupt that habitat. So, other thing that recognizing if we recognize the forest type, what we get to know is what type of species are growing in that area. So different forest types will have different species. You can't plant what's growing here in, for example, in Maharashtra. There are certain species that are common, but certain species which in Maharashtra, you can't go and plant it in some other area, like in the eastern Himalayas, because it won't be able to survive there. So we get to know what kind of species grow in that area. And if we know the composition of the forest, what we can do is we can set it as a benchmark. So like I said, in the restoration, we are trying to get back to the natural condition of the forest. So if we know the forest type, like we try and set it in our head that we have to, work towards achieving this goal. So that is why it is very much important. Then the main part is species selection. So what to plant is the major question that many restoration practitioners, they face. So basically what in this, how it can help you is, because you can't rely, many a times you can't even have in a degraded forested area, if you go, you don't have any benchmark site to look up to that this is how the forest in the surrounding is. So we would like to restore this degraded patch to that sort of a forest. So in that case, what we can do is we can rely on the traditional knowledge of the locals who have been living in that landscape for a long, long time. So these people, they know what kind of species were growing in this area. Also, there are historical records, like floras are basically books which will have descriptions of different tree species dating back to the British era when these books were published, and different species, their distribution, their growth form, and everything has been described there, and where these species grow, the range of these species, where they occur. So everything is known. And if at all you have a benchmark site, then you can do vegetation surveys in those areas. Like if there is a degraded forest here at a place and surrounding, you will see there are scattered rainforests there. So you can do vegetation surveys there to know what species are to be grown. So here I've highlighted native species is basically to tell you about the importance of using native species. So more or less what has happened is in many of these campaigns of tree planting, what has happened is many non-native species have been promoted because these are fast growing and there are less, they grow, there's no like maintenance or any such thing that is required for these non-native species. But for revival of the different wildlife species that are dependent on a forest, you will have to have native species, because these are the species that might go extinct if there's this degradation that continuously happens. And that is why the native species are very much important. Then we come to site selection. So where to plant? How do we decide where we can plant? So you have to look at the location, like how if this area, it has been degraded for how many decades, so how it was before. So you can use Google Earth imagery for that. If the site is steep, So there are different things that can be done. If the site is steep, so you'll have to have bunds. So before, you know, starting to think of planting. So the other thing that we should think of is the accessibility of the site. Because why accessibility is important is because the restoration planting is usually done in the monsoon period. So you in the peak monsoon, to reach or to transport the saplings to these sites, it becomes difficult. So if the area is accessible, and if it's not, so what can be done to, you know, take the saplings to this place? If there are natural forest regeneration sources available, if there is a forested area around this place or not, and what kind of level of degradation is observed. Based on that, we'll have to think of the steps. So if the soil condition is very worse, then you'll have to work on the soil first. You'll have to fertilize it. You'll have, if there's a lot of weed cover, you'll have to clear it first. So there are different things. Then the strategy. So after site has been selected, we know what species to plant. So how to plant them? So it all depends on the level of degradation that is there in an area. So there are different methods. I won't go in details of this, but I'll just show you, tell you briefly. So nurse species planting is basically planting certain species that would, you know, they'll grow fast. They'll try to achieve the shade, which will, you know, then support the other. It will stop the weeds from growing. Then it will support some other species or dispersers or birds to come in with seeds that will naturally, you know, try and get the forest back. There is framework species method. In this method, around 20 to 30 selected species, important species. These are selected based on different studies, and those are planted. So this process can be fastened. Then there's maximum diversity method, which we follow in our area, where maximum, like we try and plant maximum number of species, because if we do that, the chances of recovery are faster if we ourselves plant these different kind of species initially and not depend on the dispersers to get seeds. Then coming to growing trees. So the main part that, you know, restoration, we do not try and disrupt the natural regeneration process. So we don't go inside the forest to collect seeds, because that will affect their growth in the naturally forested area. So what we do is we collect seeds fallen on the ground, along the edges of the forest or along the trails or roads or riverbeds, where there are chances of these seeds to not survive. The survival chances are very low. So that is where we collect seeds from. So these are some beautiful seeds, colorful seeds that are present, that we grow in our nursery and that are found in the parquet landscape. Then coming to nursery activities. For a restoration project to be successful, the plants that we grow, they should be healthy. And that is, I mean, if the planting stock is healthy, then the restoration, you know, whatever goal you're trying to achieve, you know, is more or less, you know, it can be achieved. So various activities like year-round activities and intensive activities go on in the nursery. So in our case, we have local trained staff who do this. So I've mentioned different types of different activities that go on. So until from seeds to the level of plant, which is ready, you know, for outplanting, we take care of these saplings and we mostly grow the native tree species. Mostly not, I think I can say all of them are native tree species that we grow. Then the coming to planting activities. So in restoration, like if you think of like, there are various, you must have attended or you must have gone to various tree planting events, but you don't know how you know, intense these planting activities in a restoration site are required. So beginning with clearing of weeds. So we, if the area is highly weed covered, so we'll have to clear the weeds before, you know, planting, before 1-2 weeks before planting. Then comes digging pits. So pits also will have to be, you know, the distance of the pits, how should they be placed so that once the forest grows, it looks like a natural forested area. So all these things have to be taken care of, right? From transporting the saplings to planting. And we also label these planted saplings. Why? Because this, once we label them, we also do the monitoring of these species. Apart from monitoring, we also do maintenance. So it's not like once the saplings are planted, they are, you know, on their own and they'll be able to survive. In these naturally forested areas, what happens, or in these natural conditions, what happens is the weeds would likely to be coming up faster, and that would affect. So what we have to do is we have to maintain the planted saplings as well. So apart from maintenance, we also do monitoring of these saplings. Why? Because this monitoring will help us improve our restoration efforts in a way. So I'd like to tell you how what we have been doing. So since the inception of this project, in the beginning, we started off with just 25 species. And we started this project in 2014. We set up the nursery. Now we have 17 species, native tree species that we have been growing. And we still are, you know, adding more species to this every year. So this is how the nursery looked in 2014. So it was a very small area where the forest, we had got it with the help of the forest, local forest department, Arunachal Forest Department, and this is how it looked. And now in 2020, we have a bigger area where we could house around 25,000 to 30,000 saplings. So that is how we have improved, and the local staff has been helping us entirely in this. So these are some of the saplings that we have been growing, and these are very important for this, not only ecologically important, but also important for the local people. So like I said, our project started in 2014. We, for 2 years, we engaged in training to develop relations with the local community. And that is how, it started off. And in 2016, we did our first planting. So now I can say we have grown around 35,000 saplings in these 6 years, and covered around 12 hectares of degraded patches by planting and other restoration activities. So what we have seen is the survival has been different in different sites. We have also provided saplings to different tea estates, because in the surrounding Assam, as you all know, that it is the largest tea producing state. So they have these huge tea estates where there are some areas which are left fallow. So we have contacted these guys, and they have shown interest in, you know, planting native trees in their estates. So since these estates are very much protected, the survival was found to be very high there. But in natural conditions, mostly there is wildlife activities that is seen. So elephants come, they trample upon the, you know, the saplings, and there is less survival. But we don't really bother much about that, because that is the natural condition. So you can't stop the movement of the animal. But even if it is 30 to 50% the survival, still it is good for at least the seed dispersals to come in later on when the forest grows and starts bearing fruits. So here are some, you know, pictures that I'd like to show you all. Very interesting. So in 3 years, this plant sapling, which was very tiny when we planted, has grown up to be a big tree now. And in these rainforests, what I've observed is in our area, the trees grow very fast. I mean, there is vigorous growth that is observed. So here you can see in 2017, the same sapling, you can see in 2020, how tall it has grown. So all these things, you know, small things, watching these saplings grow gives you so much of happiness. And when you see the recovery, and I am waiting for, to go back to these areas 20, 25 years later and to see it grow, to see it to be a forest and see different animals in the areas where we have done restoration. So like I said, we also do some outreach activities. So we have provided saplings to the local communities, and we sell it at a minimal rate of 5 to 10 rupees. And we use this for our nursery maintenance activities. And many of these community people, they say that these species that that we have been growing, they have not seen them in any of the nurseries in the area. So they are thankful, very much thankful to us, because these are the species they also feel that are very important. But many of the commercial species like teak or other timber species are mostly grown in nurseries. So that is a benefit that people have got from this nursery. Other public outreach activities that we have supported are various campaigns by NGOs or Forest Department on various like days like World Environment Day or World Earth Day, where they have taken saplings from us. And we are happy that they are taking these different diverse set of species for planting. And yes, we also run a nature education program. And as a part of that program, we have local schools from this, local students from these schools in this area to visit the nursery. And we have a day, where we tell them what all activities we do and what forest restoration is. Because these are the people later on, they can take it ahead and explain it to the other people. What is the importance of, having the native tree cover? So now coming to, as I said, it's restoration is something which requires a lot of efforts. And there are various challenges. So one challenge that I'd like to tell you all is about the logistics that go into it. So some sites are very inaccessible in the monsoons, because in the northeast there's heavy rains that is observed. So we usually have to plant at the onset of monsoon, because the chances of survival of the saplings are higher, instead of planting them in the dry season where there is high mortality or death of saplings. So you can see that some areas, to reach these areas, the local team had to cross rivers, taking the saplings on their shoulders. So there are these things that go into it. So it's a backbending, and a lot of hard work goes, backbending process, and a lot of hard work goes into it. So I'd like to, briefly summarize our things that you, not being from an ecological background, but you could still, do these things or be aware of these things. Like you try and retain and protect the existing trees or the natural forest patches around your area where you live or in the campuses. So protecting these, be it non-native species, but still if they are present in your area, they can be, protected. Then use native plant species. If there is some planting campaign happening, so you can stress that we should use native tree species, because these are the species that are habituated to the environment in this area or in any area where you plant. So non-native species, they also disrupt the natural conditions in an area. So also avoiding monocultures or non-native species or invasive species. Again, the same thing, instead of planting one species, you can plant, or at least plant some 10, 15 species, different species. So that would attract different wildlife. And the main thing, you have to plant the right native species at right places. Like I said, there are things like grasslands, there are things like, grasslands are treated as wastelands because you don't see any green cover there. But you can't go and, plant at every place where you see, it's an open area, so let's go and plant. So you have to know what is the history of the area. And like I said, cost and effort involved in restoration practice is very high, and you won't get the output as expected, but still it is the need of the day. You have the forest loss is proceeding at such an alarming rate that it is important to restore forests. So these are some of the people I would like to thank who have been, who have been playing an active role in helping us restore these forests. And so these are the different researchers who have helped us, and I am very grateful to these guys who have worked in this landscape, and they're trying to stop, not stop, but stop the degradation, but trying to revive the forest where they have worked on different wildlife species. And this is our field team. Like without these guys, there is nothing. Like we can't do anything. I feel that they are the people who have been, you know, who have been there from the start of these from the start of the restoration project with us, and they still are continuing, and their efforts and their motivation is what motivation to continue is what drives us. So yeah, I hope they can be a role model for the others in the landscape, and they can take it ahead even if we have to leave leave the place in future. This is also some of the local nest protectors who have been working as members of our Hornbill Nest Adoption Program, which Karishna will be talking about. So they have also helped us in the restoration activities. And that's it. Thank you. I hope I didn't take too long, and I hope you were able to understand. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you, Nupur.
Yeah, so you can ask questions even if they're basic, so don't, you just need to ask anything. Was I audible to the entire thing?
Yes.
Okay.
Ma'am, I have a question.
Sure.
Ma'am, how do you, what are the preventive steps taken after the plantation? Like you do the plantation, and how do you take the pest control and all that stuff? How do you?
So we try to keep it as natural as possible. So like I said, we plant, we do the planting in different areas. We also provide saplings to key states. So it's a protected area. It's an area which is maintained by humans. So in these areas, what they do is they'll have proper pest control. They'll, you know, have proper care, take care of the saplings. So what we do is we provide saplings to them basically. And what they do is they'll take the protective measures and preventive measures, like you said. So they'll do pest control and things. But in our case, if we are planting in a natural habitat, what we do is we leave it as natural as possible, because like you said, that pests basically are insects. So these natural insects, they are dependent on these plants. So even if they are feeding on the foliage of the saplings, it is a natural process. So we let that happen. So there is herbivory observed. We see like the saplings, there are no leaves that we observe on the saplings, but these rainforest species are very sturdy. They fight back and they grow. And so we let it be as natural as possible in restoration. And apart from other, like I mentioned in the presentation, we do weeding. So these grasses which compete with the saplings, so to fasten the growth of saplings, we do the weeding. That is what is the minimum intervention that we try and do.
So students, you can ask questions or put in the chat box. Also, we have given a feedback form. Please fill that up as a question answer session is going on. Nupur, can you tell us what are the challenges of restoration in the reserve forest or the fringes where you are doing, and the challenges which are done in the urban areas?
Okay. So the challenges that we face in this particular landscape is, so like I said, Paakya Tiger Reserve is surrounded by various reserve forests. So every protected area has a buffer zone around it. So what has happened is there was no clear demarcation of buffer zone, and people have been living in the reserve forest for a long, long time. So what challenge that we have faced is, basically we started this project to revive the degraded areas in the reserve forest, more than the protected areas. But what we have faced as a challenge is people claim the land to be theirs, even though it is, you know, government owned or it's a protected land. But since they have been, you know, living in this, in these areas since like many decades, they've been living in these areas. So they claim, you know, ownership over these lands. So they don't let us do some restoration there because they have their personal thing.
So were they farming there or it was just a land, but they said that it's ours land?
So there are settlements in the reserve forest. So lots of settlements right from, you know, different villages. So there's cultivation also happening. And mainly cultivation that has been happening. And apart from that, you know, even if they are not doing anything, still they don't give this land away because they think that maybe in future they'll be doing something in those areas. They might construct a house or something. Yeah, so that is there. And in urban areas, as in, we haven't like done much, you know, restoration in urban green spaces as such. We haven't gone into that yet. But we usually, you know, provide, you know, consultancy to people if they want to know what species need to be grown. So, yeah, I mean, many people, they come to us and ask for our nursery species because they know that we are going native trees. From the cities close to our area. But what we tell them is that because these are forest species, they grow very tall. And in an urban setting, it becomes difficult, you know, there could be these standalone trees if they fall by chance later on when they grow very tall. So that can be a big challenge later on. So we tell them, so that's why we also grow some species which are used for avenue plantation, like, you know, Kanchan, you must have observed. So things like that, which we can give to these people, so they plant at least native species instead of exotic ones.
Right.
Yeah.
So students, you can ask question. I think this restoration topic is, you know, just getting filtered in them.
Getting synced in it.
Yeah.
I hope I wasn't too technical because this is an entirely different audience.
If I say it is a technical, but, and I knew it is going to be a technical, but you, you know, tried to make it as easy as possible to understand. So that's not a problem. And because these students, as I said, they are from various backgrounds, but they are going to, you know, go into different professions. And this particular subject, if not in the forested area, but wherever they are going to work, live, you know, this is the subject which is some point in the life everyone we are going to, you know, face. And as you just mentioned, tree plantation is such an issue that nowadays it's have become a kind of, you know, a thing which everyone wants to do every time, plantation.
But there's no thought that goes into it.
So that's why at least, you know, we could scratch a surface in their thought process with these kind of sessions. That also is good enough.
Yes,
yeah.
I completely
agree. So I think, yeah, team, if you have any questions, you can ask. Otherwise, I think we'll let them sink the subject in. And as we just spoke that Karishma will be talking in next 2 weeks about the same reserve forest and about hornbills. And then the student may come up with few more questions. We can do that. So if you have any question, you can shoot. Otherwise, we can end the session. So, Shruti, you can give vote of thanks.
It was all new and interesting for all of us. We want to know what is restoration, how it differs from reforestation, what exactly ecological succession is, and your work and efforts motivates us and realizes how important conserving forest is. Thank you, Nupur ma'am, for this interesting session. We enjoyed it a lot. I would also like to thank Shilpa ma'am for helping us to conduct this wonderful session. I thank the whole organizing team for their efforts and thank all the participants for being such a lovely audience. Thank you so much.
Thank you all. Thank you for, you know, attending it on a Sunday morning. So.